Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the December 10th meeting of the New York State Independent Redistricting Commission. Thank you all so much for coming this morning. First on our agenda, we would like to have a moment of silence to recognize the passing of former New York City Mayor David Dickens. So if we could pause for just one moment. All right. Thank you all so much, commissioners. And I want to recognize in particular Commissioner Flatteau, who was Mayor Dinkins' chief of staff. And we are all very sorry for your loss. I know it was a sad day for New York City. So in terms of our official agenda, I believe the first item is the budget. Karen and Doug, I don't know if you want to provide an update on that or perhaps the absence of an update on it. What's going on?
Unfortunately, I don't have an update. Doug, have you heard anything?
I have not heard anything, no.
All right, so commissioners, there was a letter drafted and we recognize Commissioner Frazier who helped draft it, who unfortunately cannot be here today, that was distributed last night. And I think an updated version was distributed this morning. Are there any changes to that letter that would like people like to be made? So I think before we vote on this, I just want to talk about the logistics of the letter. So since we do not have money, we do not have a website with which to distribute the letter. So I think I would propose that once we pass it, that our co-executive directors send the letter to the press list that has been used. And I would also propose that someone read the letter into the record for anyone who's currently watching. What is the commission's view on that?
I agree with that recommendation, Commissioner.
Okay.
I think there's consensus that we should do that. Why don't we read it into the record and then we can vote?
Okay. Does anyone have pride of authorship? Because I defer to anyone who would like to read it into the record.
Either one of the executive directors, doesn't matter to us.
Actually, okay. maybe not the executive directors. They're not on payroll yet.
Right.
Okay.
Does anyone have it handy? Yeah. Oh, sorry.
Keith. I do have it handy. And
okay.
Back to the days of reading is fundamental. I'll volunteer. Without further ado, dated December 10th, 2020, by email to Governor Andrew M. Cuomo, Senate Majority Leader Andrea Stewart Cousins, Speaker Carl Hastie of the Assembly, Minority Leader of the Senate Robert Ort, and Minority Leader of the Assembly William Barkley. Dear colleagues, the commissioners of the Independent Redistricting Commission respectfully request that the appropriations allocated to the commission in the fiscal years 2019-2020 and 2021 New York State budgets be released for the commission to fulfill the work that is required as stated in the New York State Constitution. As stated in our letter to you dated September 8th, 2020, the Constitution mandates this funding and does not contemplate an indefinite delay before releasing it. The legislature has appropriated to the Department of State funding for the commission, but for reasons unknown to us, that agency has failed to release this funding. Article 3, Section 5B of the New York State Constitution mandates that the necessary appropriations for the commission to perform its duties and prepare a redistricting plan by January 2022. Without the appropriated funds, we cannot execute our mandated duties within the statutory timeframe. The U.S. Census Bureau has indicated that there may be a delay in the release of apportionment numbers. However, their schedule for the released geographic products, such as Tiger Line File, has not changed. The commission must have staff hired and ready to receive this data by January 22nd, 2021. We are urging you to release this funding so we may initiate the process of hiring our staff as required by the amendment and begin the great task before us. We look forward to your response. Sincerely, the members of the Independent Redistricting Commission and the signatures of each of the commissions follows. Also copied on the letter is Budget Director Robert Mojica Jr. So ends the reading.
Thank you, Commissioner. Yes. Are there any other comments before we vote on the letter?
Might we want to include it in the copy section of the Secretary of State? I believe it's the Honorable Rosado. Since our budget is embedded in that particular agency, that's just a thought. Adding one more CC at the bottom of the letter.
I have no objection to that.
I have no objection.
No objection.
Okay. So Karen and Doug, if you could add that to the draft. Do I have a motion to adopt and send this letter as read by Commissioner Wofford?
I so move. Prior to the motion, Commissioner Mamora, look, we all know where we are from the text of the letter, but look, the urgency of this should not be understated to the public. This budget was passed in the second week of April. LAT4, which our commission independently is intended to replace, you know, has been funded to the tune of $2 million. So the state collectively knows how to do it, but they haven't done it. And we have quite a bit of work to do that we've, you know, placed in the hands of our executive directors who themselves are not even being paid yet. So we hope that there is a full-throated acknowledgement of the problem here and that it's resolved immediately. And I have nothing further unless any other commissioners want to speak before the vote.
I would especially note that the LAT4 appropriation is made in contemplation or understanding that they already have computers and phones and a place to work and all those things that are provided for them. So none of those things we've been able to purchase, nor because we haven't been, or the funding has not been released for this year, we're unable to get a sensible budget request for next year. So we're behind on that as well. So this is more than a critical moment. This is nearly existential in regard to our mission.
I would echo both our colleagues' points. You know, I would go back even further. You know, there was a $250,000 appropriation in the 2019-2020 budget, which was carried over into 2021 with the $750,000 that was appropriated this year, which is the $1 million that's there. So there's been money placed on the table now, frankly, for over 18 months. Pursuant to the state constitution, this commission was supposed to be constituted in February. April, we had a budget. Come September, we sent a letter, all of us, those that were on the commission at the time, unanimously sent a letter. We didn't get a response. We didn't get the courtesy of a response back from anyone, frankly, either of the legislative leaders, the governor's office, the division of budget. Nobody bothered to acknowledge it. And yet here we are. I understand when there are agencies and they ask for budgets and sometimes their requests and they need to be adjusted given the climate or given the resources that are available, they're discretionary. But this is a requirement in the state constitution and it takes on a certain gravitas. And I'm obviously a bit upset by the fact that they have wholeheartedly or wholesale chosen to ignore their responsibilities. No, the amendment's pretty clear. We're to be governed by this amendment. And if there's a violation of law, and I do believe at this point, this has risen to the level of being unconstitutional, risen to the level of being a violation of law, that at some point there may be a requirement to seek some sort of judicial review. This is critical. We should have had our staff in place in April. Our executive directors together back then. People talk about being a month behind, 2 months behind, 3 months behind. The reality is right now, we are at least 8 months behind in our job. And we should take that critically. And we shouldn't be afraid to say it, regardless of who it affects. This is not acceptable. I have not seen it, although we've seen great coverage in certain newspapers and Times Union and others locally to Albany. I haven't seen it in the New York Times. I haven't seen it in the Wall Street Journal. I haven't seen it even in my local paper here on Long Island Newsday, let alone the Daily News, the New York Post. It's disappointing because I remember those papers being champions of this effort back in 2010, 2011, when, you know, former Mayor Koch was running around talking about the need for independent redistricting. We passed a constitutional amendment overwhelmingly, and here we are trying to implement, and we're being stonewalled. So yeah, we should all be upset. So this letter is great. I'm glad we reached consensus on it, but let's remember there's a history here and there has to be some accountability. And it's about time we put our foot down, either individually, collectively, and got more than just concerned about it. I mean, let's get mad about it. Thank you.
Commissioners, if I may, this is Commissioner Brady. I concur completely. But in addition to every single day that goes by that the legislature is abdicating its duty and violating the state constitution, the census data is coming. Other data is coming. You're 8 months behind. We don't have an office. And it can only get worse. It becomes apparent. The pattern becomes apparent. And it becomes apparent to everybody, which is why, unfortunately, legal action might be necessary to do what legislatures are there to do what the people want them to do, to have this independent commission function properly. Unless they can come up with an excuse, which they don't have, this money must be released immediately, not with all deliberate speed, not in due time, but immediately. And I just want to emphasize that for the record. Thank you.
Just if I may also, I mean, I certainly agree with the my fellow commissioners here about the delay and what it's and the problems it's causing us. It's causing our executive directors. I think we should get more, maybe not mad, but certainly more insistent. I just wanted to two things that the last couple of commissioners said. I don't think this is I don't see it as a constitutional issue. The Constitution, I think, just says that the money has to be, quote, appropriated in the budget, which the legislature has done. And I'm not sure that it's the legislature that's holding anything up. I think, as we've known for several months, the division of the budget has kept a lot of funding from going out to a lot of other equally, if not more, deserving entities such as school districts and localities. So I understand that there's a, you know, I think we all should understand that there's a pandemic going on, that that budgets are incredibly tight, but that should not be a justification for, you know, sort of preventing us from doing anything at all. I mean, it's just, you know, it's getting a little bad. That's all. I just wanted to just make that point. Thank you.
If I may, I would say that it is my hope that we would not have to engage in any legal action, that the state government will engage with us and help us to start the job that we are meant to do, and that we will not be prevented from doing our work and being responsive to New Yorkers, right? Which are the people who we owe ourselves to. Ultimately. And I hope that we do see immediate action on this letter that we are sending in order to get our funding, get our work going, and have our executive directors actually get a salary and be able to be fully engaged in the work of the commission.
I could just add something as well. You know, any further delay would clearly kind of give rise to the consensus that and cynical consensus that, in fact, the legislature is attempting to set us up for failure for the purposes of only coming in and enacting their own LAT4 produced maps that would do what they wish to do in the bidding as normally as the majorities have done in the past. So any further delay really lends credence to the cynical belief that we're just being used here and not being used for the purpose of coming up with anything legitimate and independent as the Constitution the people requested, but merely being used as a vehicle to really just allow the legislature to go about its normal course of business and establishing its own maps as they have done in the past. So any further delay, I think, just leads credence to that type of a conclusion.
Would any other commissioners like to weigh in? I mean, I would just echo my fellow commissioner. Oh, sorry, Commissioner Fletso. Yes, sorry, Commissioner Fletso.
I endorse the sentiments of my colleagues.
Yes, and I echo the views of everyone. I think that at the end of the day, the only people hurt by this delay are the people of New York, right? What's being delayed is not the actual drawing of the lines. It's our getting public input from the people of New York. So, you know, I think that we need to move on this quickly, and hopefully our letter will be taken in the spirit with which it's presented. So do I have a motion to adopt and send the letter as discussed?
So moved.
I have a motion from Commissioner Brady. Do I have a second?
Second.
I have a second from Commissioner Cuevas Molina. All in favor?
Aye.
None opposed? It's unanimous. All right. Well, thank you, commissioners. Karen and Doug, if you could go ahead and send this with all speed to the requisite parties, as well as to the current list that we have. So next on the agenda, we had the, discussing the general timeline for the commission. I know this is very kind of up in the air. Our co-executive director, Karen Blatt, had sent out a, kind of tentative deadlines. Because this is so up in the air with the budget, I'm not sure if we definitely cannot commit to a timeline while we're on this call, but I think that it would be helpful to just kind of generally discuss the deadlines that we have and generally discuss, trying to create kind of any internal deadlines, knowing that the census data will come in April, but knowing that that might be moved, right, and might be delayed. I'm wondering if we should have some kind of commitment to finish certain things before then, and then maybe, and not to be agreed today, maybe have some kind of D-Day plus 10, D-Day plus 30 type of plan for like what we aim to do once the census data comes in. But I also defer to my fellow commissioners. What are your thoughts?
We have not had substantial time to review this, but it seems like a reasonable starting point. But I think it should be an input rather than an output. And what it should be an input to is the preparation of a staffing plan that will feed into the request to be included in the governor's budget, which I believe is in about 30 days hence. So I think there's already a very immediate homework assignment that this needs to be an input to in order to the people to determine what needs to be done in terms of people and resources, because we're quite short on time, as has already been remarked.
Yes, I completely agree with that, Commissioner.
I ask either of the two correct co-executive directors, what's the lead time do you expect to have a budget prepared, presented to the commission for our review and approval, hire the necessary staff, obviously office space, computers? What will it take for us to get from where we are today, assuming that by some act of government, I won't say of God, that someone actually releases the funds that we're entitled to today, when would we actually be in a position to begin to deal with this timeline? Because I think it's important for us to also put in that variable into this timeline. These are dates that are there. They're fixed. They may move by a couple of days given what's happening with the census. But until we understand how long it's going to take us to get to that point and be viable as a commission, that is staff, location, resources, everything starts from the point when we have our funding, and then it's plus whatever. Is it 4 weeks? Is it 8 weeks? Is it 12 weeks? What's it going to take for us to get to that point? And we need to put that on here as well, because if it were today and it were 12 weeks and it took us 3 months to get there, you know, all of these dates become almost irrelevant because we don't have the ability or the capacity to actually deal with any of the data that's coming in. So how long do you think it'll take?
Well, you ask a really good question, and it's a difficult one to answer. I think a lot of that depends on whether or not we have to do our own procurement or how much assistance we get from another agency.
I apologize. I don't mean to put both of you on the spot. Obviously, it's for discussion purposes and obviously for everyone to consider. Timeline's great, but I think the reality is we understand, unless there's a commitment from, let's say, the Department of State or OGS or somebody to make those facilities available to us so we can at least advance that aspect of what we're doing. Until we get funded, we can't even begin to address these issues, let alone the timeline.
I agree, Commissioner Martins. We need the funding so that we can have public comment periods, that we can get input from our constituents across the state of New York. We need to have office space. We need to have phone lines. We need to have people who can, get our data organized, receive it, put it into a format that is accessible to all of the members of the commission. We need to have a platform for how we are going to receive public comment and what our constituents believe are their communities of interest. And without any funding, we can't even start to do any of this work, which is essential for us as we start the work of drawing these district maps that we are required to do. So I think that what we're talking about is a tentative timeline, so that at the moment we do receive our funding, government willing, we can actually immediately start to do the work and get into that timeline and meet the goals that we want to meet, and actually get the work done in a timely fashion and get to where we need to go. So I don't think that discussing a possible timeline is a superfluous or meaningless effort. I think that we should start discussing what we plan to do so that the public knows that we are interested in doing this work, that we are just being held back by the limit of not having a budget, that we are here and that we are present and that we want to do this work as soon as possible.
Just a note, we're discussing a proposed timeline. I have not received such. I just double checked my email. I do not have one.
Is this from a prior meeting, Ms. Blatt, where there was a draft? I guess it was a task list circulated. Is that different from the timeline?
I believe the timeline was circulated with the letter by Karen last night.
Yeah.
I will send it out again. Right now.
Actually, I'd like to raise another point for the executive directors and the other members of the commission, which is, we talked about the budget, but they also need a place to sit. Among other things, and perhaps other forms of assistance. And what I'd like to remind everyone of is that the statute and the state constitution provide that the state budget shall include, and then I'll omit some words in between, and require other agencies and officials of the state of New York and its political yes. subdivisions to provide such information and assistance as the commission may require to perform its duties. So I think that if there are other things that our executive directors need, a place to sit, an internet email address, those sorts of things, to the extent that we're not going to take the money and go off to do all buy all of those things ourselves, we should be working with all deliberate speed to figure out what those other requests would be that would allow us to perform our duties. Because that's also provided for in the statute.
Agreed. We know there's plenty of office space in the Capital Region and probably in a number of other regional centers throughout the state, New York City, et cetera. I think that's a cost-effective way to proceed. Look at what other agencies also have resources that can be shared or provided to our work.
Should we be contacting OGS to suggest or actually request that they expeditiously provide for us the necessary office space that executive directors would request?
Well, Karen and Doug, you've begun those discussions, if I remember correctly, right? Or is that not the case?
We had a discussion with the Department of State about the funding. We have reached out to OGS, but there's no response yet. That's where you would get office space. We haven't been able to connect. We don't know if we have to. We don't know if it costs money. We don't know anything as far as how we would even get a lease at this point.
Was there anything we can do to be helpful in that regard?
Well, perhaps we should have a resolution here requesting the executive directors to contact or and send a request to OGS to cooperate with our executive directors to provide space so that they can have a place to sit.
Would there be any objections to such a resolution?
I agree.
Yeah.
I agree.
So moved.
Okay. Well, okay. Let us agree on the actual language. Place to sit. Perhaps we should change that a little bit.
Well, it's
Resources.
Yeah.
Resources.
Yeah. Sorry, Jack, George. I lost you.
As Jack indicated, we can recite the constitutional, or Keith indicated, we can recite the statutory language that suggests that other agencies are requested and required to provide us with assistance.
Resolved hereby that the state constitutional amendment provides that the state shall provide such information and assistance that the commission may require to perform its duties, and further, that the executive directors have and will identify certain needs such as office space that will be so required, that this commission support and encourage and demand that the requisite state actors provide such assistance as specified by the executive directors.
All right, so moved by Commissioner Wofford. Do I have a second?
I'll second.
Okay, second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay. All right, so Doug and Karen, I hope that helps you in your work. All right, I think last on our 10 of agenda was the issue of public input and soliciting public input. And I think our question is, while we remain without money, I think we should discuss how we want to go about soliciting it. And, if we should create working groups or something to that effect, in terms of creating a website, preparing press releases, outreach to organizations, et cetera. What are the commission's views on that? I mean, we could also wait until until next week or until the money comes in, but I think this is something that theoretically could begin to go forward now.
I would think the first priority, to the extent that there's anything done prior to a budget, given that it's volunteerism on behalf of our executive directors, should be a website, so we have some means of actually taking in information from the public and that the public can communicate with us.
I agree with that. And I think that we could, I don't think it necessarily makes sense for all 10 commissioners to be like micromanaging a website. I mean, I think we could fairly easily come up with, you know, a broad map of a website and say, you know, we want to have a bios page and this is a page for public input. And how do we go about doing that? So I think we could definitely proceed in doing that now, even despite not having the funding. And I agree with Commissioner Wofford on that. What are my fellow commissioners' thoughts?
Well, I agree with you, Commissioner Imamura, but I would just like to make a point with regard to our two executive directors. And I expect that the two executive directors are responsive to the commission. I don't expect that the two executive directors are responsive to the commissioners individually. They're not there to do our individual bidding. We shouldn't be calling them individually and giving them tasks individually. I just put it out there just for purposes of protocol. They're there to serve the commission and the consensus that we have in the commission. And I just want the tone and the protocol to be set now to avoid us individually taking it upon ourselves to send our executive directors on different tasks that may be priorities for us before we've had the opportunity to actually build that consensus and get the direction from the commission in general. It's not fair to them. I don't think it's fair to the commission. I think it's important that we actually set that now and agree that that's how we're going to proceed.
Any response to Commissioner Martins? I mean, I agree that we, as a full commission, we should definitely work in tandem. And I agree that is it would be unfair to, you know, for any... Yeah, and I definitely agree. And perhaps the ringtone highlights my point that it would be unfair for any individual commissioner to hijack our co-executive director's time, especially as they are currently unpaid. So I think that, and to the extent that we can work together as the commission, I think we absolutely should. And I think that anything that we should do, should be together with all of us working in tandem. So I agree.
That's the purpose. Noted. Thank you.
Yeah. So in terms of a website, is the commission in agreement that we should begin mapping a website? Because I think that that is something that will take time. And that if we, if and when we either hire a vendor or find some other, entity within the state government who can put together a website, if we can give them, a map and say, this is what we would like to do, I think that would speed things up substantially. So is there any objection to doing that? And as well as, and I know that we had agreed as a commission either at the last meeting or a couple of meetings ago to ask that Karen and Doug begin compiling a list of entities to approach vis-a-vis getting public input. So is there any objection to proceeding with that?
Objection. Just one question, which is, as part of the website effort, if the executive directors could inquire as to the information security protocols that the state has in place. That is, if we have a website, I don't want us to be flooded with things that are illegitimate or have the thing crashing or hacked or what have you. And I'm sure the state has some protocol for dealing with that. I don't know what it is, but certainly our executive directors should inquire as to that as part of the effort.
Sorry, go ahead, Commissioner.
That's all right. I would just say that I do have a somewhat uncomfortable feeling about asking work of our executive directors when we are not paying them. And I, even though it makes sense to go ahead with this, we need to get that money released. This is unfair to people who are actually made to answer to other people for their income. They're contemplated to be full timers. We are not necessarily. So I'm just to add again that this is points out the importance of getting our money released. And additionally, developing this kind of information so that we can do a reasonable budget submission for next year, the timing of which we're behind. I'm going to guess everybody else has had their submission in for some time. So yes, we should do this, but it makes me very uncomfortable to be asking people who have yet to be paid by us to do this work.
Yeah, and I agree with you, Commissioner. And I think that, you know, I think we unfortunately are in this position now where we're balancing multiple factors. But yes, I agree with that. So I would also ask, and we have discussed this, communities of interest mapping and our approach to that. I would just ask our co-executive directors to continue their research into that as well and get back to us on potential options. Is there any? Sorry.
No,
Commissioner Brady, sorry.
CSL forum in early January. That is, it's there. Obviously, we're not funded, but there is a fee for it. I think these kinds of forums are important, certainly for the executive directors, but also for us as commissioners to participate in, engage in those discussions, find out what best practices are across the United States with other states and what they're doing, and hopefully incorporate some of those into our efforts as well. So if there is funding available, I think that we should obviously appropriate a portion of that to, at the very least, ask our executive directors to participate. Each of us can make that decision for ourselves between now and, I believe, it's the first or second week in January. But if someone can circulate the link, and then everyone can obviously, given the resources, decide whether or not it's something we can do, I think it's worthwhile. I'm hoping that we have the resources in place from the state for the commission to actually address those expenses. But if they don't, should be something on everyone's agenda, if you can, to at least look into it.
It's I think it's the 6th, the 7th, and the 8th that the NCSL is doing this forum and providing basic training for persons that will be involved with redistricting across the nation. And I definitely support this idea. I was already planning on participating in it, but of course, I do believe that it should be part of the commission's budget to cover the expenses of participating in this event.
Yes, I think it's going to be a fantastic presentation. I agree, Commissioner Martins. I also recommend NCSL's redistricting law handbook, which ideally the commission, each commissioner can purchase and have be reimbursed for from the budget. So, any other agenda items, Commissioner
Brady? Not an agenda item, just not to go off, but for the all-important groups, the communities of interest that you mentioned, not only the fora that as commissioners, we can attend in our due diligence, but the fora that we might hold and the place to store the information, whether it's via a website or whatever rudimentary beginnings can be had, these communities of interest and these groups and these professionals who are practically, are the ones who are being stymied right now, in addition to this commission, should implore the persons or people or bodies that can get this funding out so that they can have the input that they want, whether it's the executive branch, if they know who to contact, or if they want to contact our equivalent of GSA, I'm sorry, you can put in the right acronyms, or they want to contact the governor's office or the state legislature, they should feel free to let their beliefs be known that they're being stymied and that this commission is being stymied, and get us the funding. All quarters that are being stymied should be outraged by this and take whatever appropriate action. And that's what the democracy is about, and that's what we're trying to ultimately. Those are the people we count ourselves among that we ultimately want to serve. I implore anybody to If you've got a pen, you've got a pad, if you're a community of interest and you're not able to or you fear that we're not going to be able to do our jobs, then you should let your voice be heard. Thank you.
Thank you,
Commissioner Imamura.
Commissioner Banger, yes, Commissioner Wofford, yes.
Oh, sorry, if Commissioner Banger was pending, go right ahead.
Well, I thought you had your hand up, Commissioner. Sorry, go ahead, Commissioner Wofford, sorry.
No, just following on Commissioner Nesbitt's comment about the executive directors and their work presently without compensation, although hopefully we'll fix that. I'd like to see if there would be consensus on the commission to have those executive directors ask as part of the discussion with the other state entities about provision for the benefits for the prospective employees that the commission would hire, because it is not clear to me how they as full-time employees would have their benefits provided for, and I think it's going to make it difficult to expeditiously hire people when the time comes if we don't have an appropriate view as to what benefits they're going to be receiving and where those benefits are coming from.
Is there any objection? I think that is a very good point, Commissioner Walker. That's a great point. Yes.
That's
yes.
Part of their compensation package.
Yeah.
Sure. All of this goes back, I mean, we've come full circle. All of this goes back to the fact that these questions are things we should have been dealing with in February and March,
yes,
not in middle December. Absolutely on point. Thank you, Commissioner.
Anything else that any commissioners would like to discuss? Karen and Doug, anything besides being paid, anything that you want to bring up? All right. Well, thank you so much. Do I have a motion to? Oh, I'm sorry. In terms of scheduling a meeting, would we like to schedule a new? When would we like to schedule our next meeting?
Maybe 2 weeks.
So 2 weeks from now is Christmas Eve, right? So and I think.
Okay. I would think after January at this point,
I hesitate about doing January because like everyone says, there is so much to do. And if the money is allocated, I think at least I personally would like to move on that, but I defer to the commission.
I would propose Tuesday, December 22nd.
I'm available. I agree with that.
Okay.
That's fine. I would just suggest that if funding becomes available, and if we are funded, we should hold a meeting immediately. And if we aren't funded, I don't know that there's a point in getting back together by December 22nd, and perhaps we should be flexible and hold it, you know, first week in December. But I'll defer to the majority. I am available on the 22nd if for no other reason, just to wish everyone a happy holiday.
I agree. I would say that it's appropriate to schedule a meeting. We may or may not have business based on whether or not we have funding, but I'm with you, David, in regard to feeling so uncomfortable about delaying. And I agree with Senator Martins that should have a meeting immediately upon receiving actual funding. This is really, really, really getting to be an uncomfortable moment. I was the state agency head. Budgets were submitted by any agency months ago. We're in trouble in terms of next year's funding unless we can get this money released and get busy.
Well, I mean, can't we also, you're right that we probably aren't going to make it for the governor's request, but as the as the legislature did last year, I think they could add us to their budgets.
I guess the question is, do we want
to we'll need to give them an amount though. Right.
Yeah.
Sorry.
The question is, do we want to meet the 22nd even to consider an outline of what we would request for next year's budget for the January executive budget? I don't love the idea of going to January without any sort of input from our executive directors on a directional level of funding, because then we're just in ether and there's by definition potentially nothing in the governor's budget.
Yeah, I agree with setting a provisional meeting and then And then if we get funding before then, going forward with an immediate meeting. I unfortunately cannot do the 22nd unless it's in the afternoon.
Any time of day is okay with me. I'm done with the semester.
The 2 p.m. on the 22nd? Okay.
Yes.
No objection to 2 p.m. on the 22nd?
To be confirmed.
Yes. And hopefully we can proceed. We will be able to proceed with an emergency meeting along lines that Commissioner Martin said before then. But if now, not, we will. Sorry, Commissioner Flotto.
Yeah, I just wanted to pick up on Commissioner Watford's point, if I understood it. Well, and I think Commissioner Nesbitt, that we're very late in the budget formulation process right now for next fiscal year's request, and that we need to have at least an overall target number. Maybe we can work very closely on that at our next meeting, because as prior our other commissioners mentioned, there have been budget hearings that started back in September for next agencies next year's of fiscal budgets, and we need to get that number. Right now, we're behind the curve trying to get resources for the current fiscal year, which only has one quarter left. And at the same time, budgets are being formulated for the next fiscal year right now, and we need to have a number for our next year's budget as well that we come up with. And, you know, it may be a little sloppy making sausage, but I think I totally agree with that point. Otherwise, we'll miss that boat. We don't just want to be at the mercy of some last minute add-on where you know, the legislature picks a number out of the hat that in no way gives us next fiscal year's resources when our work really goes into gear. So I think maybe between now and our next meeting, hopefully on the 22nd, we can zero in on that issue of what is our number, our request for next year's budget for the IRC. At least some type of overall ballpark number.
I agree, Commissioner. Does anyone have any thoughts? I agree with that. And if Karen and Doug, I know that this is an almost impossible task to do, but to the extent that we could ask you to begin putting this together. I know that you both have budgets from other redistricting commissions. Commissioner, any other input?
What if they just give us what they give LAT for?
That's one way to approach it.
I'm not sure that's enough. LAT for is already equipped, has provided space by the legislature. They have contracts in place. We're in a situation where we're going to be asking to make contractual commitments, some equipment purchases without even knowing what our availability of resources from other agencies is. We're the first ones to do this, but certainly we would be a great example for future commissions of what not to do, because this all should have started back in February. The Constitution contemplated an immediate appointment of executive directors. I think that 250 was there to pay them. None of that happened. And this foot dragging has gone on too long. We have large problems here in terms of physically completing our mission, and first of many is just getting this original allocation monies released. Doug and Karen are going to have to imagine what our availability or rental or what contracts might be or what equipment they might need based on an IFCOM of this or that. This work all should have been done months ago, and the fact that that it hasn't been done puts us in a very difficult position today.
Yeah, I'd like to further what Commissioner Nesbitt is saying, and that the number should be higher rather than lower, and LAT 4 is not the appropriate reference for two important additional reasons. First is that LAT 4 isn't called for by the statute as we are to interact with people all over the state as this process rolls forward in the next fiscal year. That's number one. Number two, there are multiple statutory and constitutional edicts with which we're going to have to comply, and we're going to need guidance on those. So if we could just hide away in some office building in Albany and come up with it on our own, not talk to anybody, you know, the same number might be appropriate, but we have a constitutional mandate to do much more than that. So, you know, if anything, what LAT 4 has done is a wholly inadequate low bar as to what we're going to need in terms of the budget. And so I agree with Commissioner Nesbitt and Commissioner Martins.
Anything else on this topic? So I think Karen and Doug, you have been given an impossible task to budget for this. If you could please come together and then we will discuss this at our next meeting. I think that there's going to be a lot to discuss. You know, I think one item that we haven't talked about is legal counsel and what we're going to do with that. There are seven lawyers on this call, so we definitely need legal counsel. You know, but yeah, is there anything else?
Any lawyers?
Anything else that commissioners would like to discuss on today's meeting? All right. Well, do I have a motion to adjourn? Keeping an
so
eye
move.
Out. All
so
right.
Move.
So move second. All in favor?
Aye.
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 All right. Thank you all so much. And we will potentially see you on December 21st or hopefully before then. Thank you.
22nd.
22nd.
2 p.m.
2 p.m. That's right.
Thank you,
everyone.
Thank you, commissioners.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you.